Natural disasters have always threatened and occasionally engulfed our communities. Now, 20th century technology has brought additional horrors to menace mankind, including the worst catastrophe of all, nuclear war.
No government can prevent such disasters occurring, but a responsible government must do what it can to foresee and forestall catastrophe, and should the worst happen, take best care of its citizens. Whether it's flooding in a tiny corner of the country, the impact of conventional warfare, or the devastating effect of nuclear weapons, the right response can mitigate their effects. Emergency planning can make a big difference to survival. That's why, across the country, an emergency planning network has been set up as an insurance policy against disaster, entrusted with the job of civil protection.
In Britain, we have a strong tradition of doing all we can to protect our own communities. In the last war, few were deemed too old to play their part on the home front. Civilian air raid wardens gave the forewarning of air attack that saved countless lives. Since 1945, the threat of war has receded. Now, volunteers involved in civil protection face a new range of emergencies. But one continuing concern, to be alert to the possibility of attack from the air, is still recognized. Because of our vulnerability to such an attack, the government has always given a high priority to a nationwide air watch system. The UK Warning and Monitoring Organisation can alert us to both conventional and nuclear attack.
Toxin 25 post 2021 0.3.
It also monitors fallout, providing detailed scientific data on its movements. It's a purely wartime role, and it could make all the difference to our survival after a nuclear attack.
Attention, this is the Group Controller. The situation as I see it...
The operation is run in peacetime by a small permanent staff of highly qualified experts. But like every other part of civil protection, it relies crucially on thousands of volunteers, largely members of the Royal Observer Corps. Forewarning is a vital element in our defences.
But the best defense of all, of course, is prevention. That's why every government since World War II has relied on a policy of nuclear deterrence as the principal safeguard against nuclear attack. This is what distinguishes Britain's stance from neutrals like Switzerland or Sweden, where the policy has been to build nuclear shelters instead. But despite its success so far, deterrence can provide no absolute security. Besides, as Chernobyl or Flixborough have shown all too clearly, disaster can strike just as unexpectedly from other quarters. Over the years, therefore, the role of civil defence has broadened to include planning for any kind of major accident in peace and war. And this broader approach, which we now call civil protection, has been encouraged by new legislation carried out by Parliament.
Several organisations share the responsibility for civil protection. The Home Office has the overall coordinating role, though many other government departments have a part to play. The day-to-day practical responsibility lies with the local authorities across the country. Each local authority has a county emergency planning officer, known from the initials as CEPO for short, whose full-time job is to look after the community's civil protection needs. County Emergency Planning Officer can call on the standing emergency services like police, ambulance and fire brigades. To help him, there are also voluntary organisations like the Women's Royal Voluntary Service and the St John's Ambulance Brigade, or the communications organisation known as RAINET. Finally, completing the network are the groups of scientific advisers and the thousands of community volunteers. So the daily practical job of civil protection begins at community level with the local authorities. The primary responsibility is in the hands of chief executives. In Essex, it's Robert Adcock. What advantage, in his view, is there to giving him this extra burden?
I think the benefit of it is in the day-to-day workings of the county. I have regular contact with all the services. I only have to ask any of the chief officers in respect of their services, would you please do this or please do that? They're technically responsible to me. I don't know of anyone else who could, if you like, pick up a phone in an emergency and say, we've got a crisis here or a crisis there and I want this. And they do it because they're all part of my team.
The key figure in community protection in each local authority is the county emergency planning officer. Men like Roger Chick of Warwickshire. To him, all emergencies are similar in the actions they require, only the scale varies.
But the actual aircraft which came down was a Boeing 737 with approximately 130 passengers and crew on board. Now, it's our belief at the moment that it was a crew of five.
Today, he and his planning team are discussing how to deal with a plane crash in their area and its impact on a small community. They must be ready to cope.
The role of the County Emergency Planning Officer is to prepare plans to mitigate the effects of disaster, be that disaster in peace or in war, for the people who might be affected by that disaster.
Mr. Chick, if I may ask you a question, you've identified some, I think it's 63...
In a crisis like this, he works from an emergency centre. All local authorities must have one ready for use at all times. Its purpose is to make sure that the SEPO, with his chief executive and the civil protection team, can get a complete and up-to-date picture of whatever emergency has hit their community. It's equipped to allow them to respond as effectively as possible to any situation.
The emergency planning officer is always behind the scenes. Depending upon the type of incident, we would start off as a backup service. If you take a standard peacetime emergency situation, quite clearly the most important thing to start with is the saving of life and the protection of property. But once you come to a point where it's the cleanup operation, and priorities would then change. You're not looking at the life-saving, but you're looking at the caring for the lives that have been saved. And that is when the total function of the local authority would come into being. So in that case, we would be leading. In the first case, we would be supporting.
SEPOs, of course, rely heavily on the standing emergency services, the ambulance service, police, and the fire brigade. In a few areas, like Lincoln, it is the fire brigade itself that has the responsibility for civil protection. In supporting roles are various voluntary organisations, like the Women's Royal Voluntary Service, St John's Ambulance and the Red Cross, all with a long tradition of community work. Another important group who help in emergencies are the specially trained community volunteers. RayNet is another voluntary organisation, a communications network that's made up of amateur radio enthusiasts, ready to play their part in an emergency. Their contribution could be helpful when more conventional forms of communications have failed. Performing other vital tasks are volunteer scientific advisors, doctors, scientists, teachers.
In the Chernobyl incident, they didn't really seem to get a slow temperature rise.
They're all prepared to give specialist assistance to SEPOs in time of emergency. These are the people who've taken on the responsibility, either full or part-time, for civil protection. It's they who we rely on to help us whenever disaster strikes. Flixborough, 1974. Salford, Greater Manchester, 1982. Abbeystead, 1984. Tragedies that were never envisaged, but they happened. An emergency planner's nightmare, but also the reminder of what the SEPO's job entails, that he and his team must be prepared for all eventualities, however unexpected. The more heavily industrialized the region is, and the more densely it is populated, the greater the range of risks he faces. Installations above a certain size are obliged to draw up elaborate contingency plans. To safeguard the public and maintain their confidence, good cooperation between industry, emergency services and local authority emergency planning departments are vital. Coryton in Essex. The Mobil oil refinery is one of 43 installations classified as hazardous in this heavily industrialized area. Each week, a full-scale exercise takes place. Every employee is trained in firefighting. Mogul's own in-house fire service has 16 full-time firemen. With over 400 million gallons of oil on site, they can't afford to take risks. Mogul has been here for over 30 years and has never had a major accident. On this occasion, their vigilance gets them to the fire in 2 minutes. This particular exercise is run together with the Essex County Fire Brigade. Tony Steen, Mobil's safety officer, explains the procedure to Martin Simpson, Essex SEPO, and Eric Alley, a visiting Home Office advisor. This exercise has gone without a hitch. Within 5 minutes, the fire is out.
Thanks, Jerry.
All right.
Thanks for coming down.
That's okay.
Always useful.
Yeah. I'm all glad right. We was able to get you in time.
Fine. Cheers, Dad. Thank you very much.
It is important to the SEPO that Mobil maintains the closest possible relationship with the local fire brigade. They practice together twice a year. But what's the role of the Home Office observer, Eric Alley?
I go around the country, I look at what local authorities are doing, assess and evaluate their work and see how they're matching up to the statutory functions which are laid upon them to be able to look after people.
Presumably, if you come to an area like this, it's easier than in some other places to convince people of the importance of emergency planning.
Well, that's right, because people around here, people in Essex generally, can see the problems that face them. They can see the day-to-day hazards that are about. Whereas if you go to some of the more country areas, some of the country areas in Wales and so on, they're not truly aware of all the various problems that face us over the whole range of the disaster scenarios.
In isolated areas like Norfolk, a strong sense of community is a great help to emergency planning officers.
So we'll be teaching you to use spars of timber for levers. We'll
Alan Mackey, who's District Emergency Planning Officer for South Norfolk, is of course a full-time professional, and he's built up a network of local community advisors down. Around him. No we keep thoroughly briefed.
Enter into the training, and I think you'll find after you've seen the film that it's a worthwhile course and you'll learn a lot and you'll enjoy it.
In the end though, the system can only work through the active cooperation, enthusiasm and increasing professionalism of volunteers throughout the country, like these men and women in Norfolk, giving up their weekend to take part in a rescue exercise. They're putting into practice what they've been learning all year.
You only need just a little loop.
This is the fifth such exercise to be held in South Norfolk.
Favourite symbol, that's the answer.
That one over here.
Put two on this side. Try it and see. This bloke's dying down here, so, you know, let's have a bit of urgency in it.
Ah, wait a moment.
The volunteers in South Norfolk District come from all sorts of walks of life. I have folk who are unemployed. I have clergymen, office workers, factory workers, men and women, and of all ages. They are generally the sort of people that you would expect to volunteer for worthy causes anyway. But there's certainly nothing extra special about them, except that they feel that civil defence is something worth doing.
Whip the big rope off, keep him strapped.
Mackey has deliberately chosen his team from people known and trusted in their own villages, to whom a sense of responsibility to their community comes naturally. People like Annette Vergette.
I'll go in if I can get in.
So we need safety lines attached. Wait for Steve to come through.
I don't see it as a war game. I actually see it that they're teaching me a skill that hopefully, it sounds twee, but hopefully makes me a better member of my community, so that if my family, my children, my neighbours are ill, in trouble, I can help them. And I really don't relate it at all to war. I relate it totally to something within my community. I have to be honest and say I wish that it was better structured and I wish more people knew about it. At the moment, it's very, very low-keyed. I think we should take it more seriously.
Is your head all right?
Mackey, too, is critical of the low priority he feels civil protection is given within central government. But he knows his own team are doing the best they can, and he makes sure their training gives them the confidence to cope. South Norfolk District is right behind Mackey in his work. They appreciate that along with his relaxed manner goes an acute concern for the need to be vigilant.
If it was suggested that, for example, Sizewell, which is not far away from where we are now, suffered a major accident and a major release of radiation were to affect this area, then I can honestly say that there would be chaos. But with an organisation which has had some training, which has a plan, and which is in some respects prepared, then there would possibly be some order coming out of that chaos.
What would your top priorities be at the moment to improve our emergency planning in this country?
An increase in the awareness of people of the need to make plans for emergencies. Coming back to what you said just now, there are so many who say, well, it couldn't happen here. I particularly face this problem in rural Norfolk. People suggest, well, there are no Flixburys, for example, in rural Norfolk. But there are Flixburys on wheels going down the roads of Norfolk daily.
You mean tankers?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Chemical carrying vehicles and road and rail tankers. And they can and do leak and explode and crash. And these incidents could well occur in an urban area. So to say just because we haven't got a major chemical complex on our doorstep that something like that couldn't happen, it could and certainly does happen, and we've got to be prepared for it.
This is the emergency centre at Lincoln. The emergency planning officer is Pat Curley of the Fire Service, on his way to brief a crisis committee meeting of voluntary and professional services about an all too probable scenario of flooding in Lincolnshire.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning, Scully.
I'm sure you'll have heard it yesterday morning reports of severe wind conditions affecting shipping off the Scottish coast, wind gusts up to 125 miles an hour, etc. They seem to have centred on Alford, and our reports indicate that local people have opened up the John Spendlough School at Alford and are receiving...
This exercise is being run jointly by firemen and civilians from the County Emergency Planning Department and the Women's Royal Voluntary Service. It's one of three exercises they hold together every year.
Clothing presents no problem, and I know that we've already got some clothing sent to Alford, but blankets, I wonder if any arrangements have been made for issuing the extra supplies of blankets.
The WRVS volunteers will cook and serve a hot meal in field conditions to 100 refugees. This presents few problems for them. 150,000 volunteers nationwide do this kind of thing regularly, turning out for all kinds of crises at the request of the emergency services. They say they can cope with anything. Fire Chief George Moore was there to take a look at the volunteers at work.
But it clearly shows that it can work, and it does work.
Yeah.
But it does take time to organise.
Thank you.
We have regular meetings with the emergency planning officer. We meet the police, we meet the fire brigade, and we go and cook for the fire brigade if they're at a major fire. So we're in constant touch.
Now, I can understand how you could play an important role in peacetime emergencies, because after all, you deal with them every day. But how have you managed to extend this role to include preparations for nuclear war?
Well, I think you're looking at Chapter 13, the nuclear scenario. It doesn't make any difference in relation to the planning. You plan for all hazards. You plan for a civil contingency. You would be utilising the same resources, whether it be peacetime or wartime. So you don't plan just for nuclear. You plan on an all hazard. You plan to encompass all organisations, voluntary, commercial, all those organisations which you have to work with on a day-to-day basis now, you encompass them within the one overall plan. And from our point of view, in relation to the planning I'm talking about now, there is no problem whatsoever. In fact, it's far easier.
Nuclear war is a possibility most people prefer not to contemplate. But this is not an option available to emergency planners. So the Home Office has its own research program investigating the impact of nuclear weapons. Dr. Roy Pover, a biochemist, is involved in calculating their possible effects. He's a regional scientific advisor, one of the experts interpreting and augmenting the Home Office research. His particular concern is the welfare of survivors.
We are going to have blast fatalities, and people are going to die. And of course, there'll be a lot of people who will survive this. Now, this, of course, means we've got to worry very much more about the survivors and the casualties and what to do with them.
From research being carried out, the likely effects of a 1 megaton bomb can be established. Within a few miles of the center of an attack, the devastation and loss of life is almost total. But the further you go from direct impact, the less the damage to people and property. Certainly beyond 10 miles, houses and human beings would be almost unaffected by the blast. Radiation, of course, is a different matter. Its effect depends a great deal on weather conditions, like the wind. And it can certainly spread hundreds of miles in a particular direction. But the point about radiation is that you can protect yourself from its worst effects.
The fallout downwind will affect people who have not been affected by blast. And these people, if they take proper precautions, such as taking shelter and keeping out of the way of the radiation, then they have a good chance of survival.
In facing the ultimate emergency posed by nuclear war, we would all rely heavily on what is done here at the Civil Defence College at Easingworld. It's both a think tank and a training centre for emergency planning. Through the hands of tutors like Ken Kennedy, pass 3,000 men and women a year, professionals and volunteers. Here they learn of the harsh realities of war and act out their responses.
10, 23, that's okay.
They will need to know how to cope with the impact of conventional warfare as well as nuclear. For while the lack of experience of nuclear war poses the greatest problem for planners, attack by conventional means is the more probable scenario.
I've learned quite a lot out of it, and seeing how the switch of resources is managed and the...
Here is an emergency announcement. An air attack is approaching this country. Go to cover and take shelter immediately.
Okay. Decision, we open the auxiliary centre.
In the hot seat exercise for local authority officers, they actually assume their wartime roles and come face to face with the decisions they could be forced to make.
People in Broxley, the homeless, should go to them. The information should be passed by people in Broxley as and when possible to people wandering homeless.
We think that there should be...
Then they sum up their findings in front of the whole course and formulate a post-attack plan for their county.
Get the people digging, get them working for themselves, producing their own food.
Not everyone who comes to Easingworld goes along with its philosophy of preparing for nuclear war. Representatives of nuclear free zones who want us to abandon nuclear weapons assert that the college puts forward an unduly optimistic view of nuclear war, which merely makes conflict more likely, and that emergency planning is just part of an aggressive defense policy with a humanitarian veneer. Ken Kennedy is familiar with this view.
As I often say to them, you're arguing mostly on moral grounds. Now, no one's going to argue. I mean, nuclear weapons are immoral. They're an abomination. No one would argue about that, but they're with us. I hate to come out with this hardy annual, but you can't disinvent knowledge. They're not going to disappear overnight. And while I'm with them all the time in trying to get rid of these wretched weapons, and I'll go along with them. And it's what we can't get across them is that we are on parallel lines. And let me give you an example, if I may. I used to be responsible for training scientific advisors. They're a group of volunteers who work for local authority. And we went to our annual seminar where we played an exercise. And at the end of that time, a rather pompous gentleman got up and said, when is the government going to do something about these left-wing weirdos from CND? And there was a deathly hush because the chap sitting alongside me had been wearing his CND badge all the way through. And he turned around and he said this, left-wing I am, bearded I am, weirdo I am not. I believe... I've been a member of CND ever since I was about 16. I want to get rid of weapons. I believe they're immoral, and I will do everything in my power to get get rid of the nuclear weapons in this country. But I'm also a realist. I realise that time is not on my side. And it may be that we won't have time to get rid of them. So what I want is an insurance policy.
And that, in the end, is what civil protection is essentially about. It's an insurance policy against emergencies. Men and women around the country are trying to ensure that we're protected by the best means available to us should disaster strike.
The national government have a need, have a role, and that is providing the overall view, general ideas, general scenarios of what is going to happen. But locally are the people who are going to have to put it into practice. And if they're the people who are going to have to practice it, they're the ones who are going to have to practice for it and plan for it.
In the past, we haven't been open with the public on what we do. And hopefully, certainly what I'm trying to do here is to open up the whole field of civil defence, which in turn might lead to a better informed public and more volunteers.
Nobody will ever be good enough anyway. This is a constant process. No plan is ever good enough. You've got to be constantly revising it, refining it, testing it, evaluating it, and so on. It's an ongoing process. It's a live thing. So nobody will ever be good enough. Nobody, you can never say anybody, will be at the top of the tree. There'll always be another peak to scale.
I can understand you can, if you want to, drive a double-decker bus through the government's civil defence policy. The alternative is to do nothing, and that is a path down which I can't go. It's really as simple as that. We do what we can with what we've got. It may not be enough for our critics. It may be too much for other people, but the alternative is to do nothing, and I can't go on. It's as simple as that.